Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
The country has chosen to honor you on your birthday, and we just praise you and lift your name up above all names. And we thank you for sending your son Jesus to be born, to walk with us as a man, and die for our sins. We ask for your guidance in everything we say and do this evening. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Bill. This time we'll call the meeting to order. Again, welcome to all of you. You're ready for Christmas and all the fun shopping and trees and everything going on, and we'll tend to business here tonight. We do not have any public comments. Anyone signed up for public comment? I will ask if any commissioner has, not necessarily a response, but any comment before we move into our formal agenda. Any opening comments? Hearing none, we'll review the agenda for approval. Commissioners, if you'll take a minute and review the items there along with what's in the consent agenda. If there's any item in the consent agenda you wish to pull from consent and discuss, let's do that at this time. Craig, I'll ask if you have any changes to the agenda as we have it.
No, sir.
I'd like to pull B and E.
B, Community Services Block Grant Application, and E, the approval of the minutes of the joint special meeting. David, are you wanting to review the minutes of both meetings? Or
no, on the minutes, the only problem I have is I was not here for those minutes, and I think I should recuse myself in the voting on it. I don't have the authority, I don't think, to pass on those minutes.
That was before December?
Yes.
Yeah, it was. Can we make that change?
That's
right. Given that change and correction, David, can we put them back on consent then with that change?
Oh, yeah, I have no problem with that.
Okay, so item B, Community Services Block Grant Application, we will pull. And why don't we move that to after the budget amendment with the health department, and we'll just make that item 9A. Is that all right there, buddy?
Yeah.
Sure. Okay. Any other changes or additions to the agenda? If not, we entertain a motion to approve the agenda, which will include the remaining items on the consent agenda. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
I second.
Thank you, Linda. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. We will now welcome presentation by the Friends of the Library. MJ, are you here? Hi. You've got your whole group here. Wonderful. Welcome. Welcome.
She brought her
Susan,
band
how are
with
you?
Her also.
She brought her fan club.
Mm-hmm. We're good. Good. Welcome to you, Susan.
Hi, guys. I'm Susan Gant. I'm a board member and I'm past president of the Friends of the Public, Alamance County Public Libraries. If you're not familiar with the Friends of the Library, our purpose is to support the library, to enhance library programs. Many of you know that our big book sale that we have twice a year raises money to give a lot of the little extras to the library that make our library system so special. And another one of our roles is to advocate for the library and its programs in the public forum such as this. I'd also like to introduce a few more people. You know MJ Wilkerson, your library director. We have Lynn Taylor, the current president of the Friends Board, and Mary Carter, Jeff Tudor, who are board members as well. And did I miss any other board members? No. I hope some of the rest of you are also members of the Friends of the Library. I'm also the co-chair of this coming year's Alamance Reads event, along with MJ. And it's for this purpose that we come here tonight. Our largest project is Alamance Reads, and it's beginning in January with a kickoff showing of the movie To Kill a Mockingbird at the Graham Cinema with free popcorn and drinks. The county's library system and our nonprofit are joining efforts to present To Kill a Mockingbird, the book and the movie, in a 5-week series of literacy, education, and fun. We've planned multiple showings at different venues, a visiting author, and a forum for the Innocence Project. There will be cook-offs, art and writing contests, book club discussions, music, art and crafts events, and more. It's going to be a grand celebration, and we hope that you'll join us. We have some friends who are joining us, too. We're collaborating with the Alamance County Arts Council, the Historical Museum, Children's Museum of Alamance, the Paramount Theater, the Graham Cinema, many schools, retirement facilities, the Kernodal Senior Center, and book clubs throughout the county. To Kill a Mockingbird was chosen for this biannual event because of its broad range of appeal to different ages and cultural backgrounds. We know that it will stimulate important discussions and will hopefully strengthen interest in reading for many of our citizens. In the book, Atticus Finch is asked by his six-year-old daughter, Scout, why he's willing to take on such a difficult case defending Tom Robinson, which he expects to lose. He explains that it's his civic duty, that he wouldn't be able to hold his head up if he did not try to do a good job for the accused. We know that as county commissioners, you're also called upon to do a civic duty, which can often be difficult. We would like to thank you and hope that you'll join us in this celebration of a timeless story. Of a token of our esteem, we have a small gift for the Friends of the Library, which includes a schedule of events, and we hope that you'll lend your presence to this countywide event. So we have each a little gift bag for you, and it includes a copy of your very own of To Kill a Mockingbird and the schedule of events that's going to take place. I hope all of you in this audience would love to come to the library and pick up a copy of your own for $7 or check out a copy. Of course, all the events are free and open to the public.
Thanks, MJ.
In your gift bag, in addition to your book, you'll find a pound cake.
Whoa.
All right. A Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola and some peanuts.
Wow.
Because they're from the book.
You'll also find an application for a library card if you don't currently have one. You'll find an application to become a member of the Friends of the Library. And we do hope that you'll join us in this great celebration. If you don't know how great our public library is, you need to get down there and see for yourself. Somebody said that the library is the great equalizer. Everybody from homeless men to senators walk in there at some point in their lives. It's the place in our county that you want to go to, unlike some of the other ones and the county funds and supports. We're wondering if you would be a part of our ad campaign. We have a series of ads in the Times News called What Page Are You On? And it's of different people reading their books. We're wondering if we could take your photo so that you could be one of our people in our ad campaign.
So everybody pulled out their book.
I didn't get a cake.
Well, I want to say, too, that the Harvard Museum participates
yes,
the reading program.
We're having one of our book discussions there, I do believe. Mm-hmm.
Don't have the books behind your eyes.
You got to hold it up high.
Are we supposed to look at you or the book?
Book.
We'll make sure.
I'm supposed to be thoroughly engrossed in that book.
Bill, yours is upside down.
Oh, wait a minute, MJ, wait a minute. MJ, wait a minute.
We need yours higher. You're hidden by your heart.
There we go.
Excellent.
And we do thank you for letting us come to the meeting.
Susan, thank you. And thank you for all that you do and your board. It's good to see everyone here tonight. Good luck to you.
Thank you.
Well, we got books and cakes and Coke. Let's see what the next group's going to bring in. And I'm going to ask Linda, who is on the board and the executive committee of the Piedmont Triad Regional Council, to introduce item 7, if you would, please.
Okay. We have with us Matthew Dodge, who is the chairman of the Piedmont Triad Regional Council, and also Del Fry, who is the executive director. Even Darrell is the chair. And what they are doing tonight, they also brought this little, and I want to read this too. They brought us something, if anybody's interested. This shows what we pay it from the county, which is $33,000. And in return, we get back $1,114,610, because all the money for aging services goes directly to the Piedmont Triad Regional Council. And then they dole it out to all the counties. So just wanted everybody to know that. So at this time, we are looking to build a building, and I'm going to let Mr. Doge tell you about that.
Welcome, sir. Chairman Manning, Commissioners, I just leaned over to Chairman Fry and said that we would get to go after the people who brought presents, and we don't have any of that. So we get the bad part.
That's
on
like you feed us every time we go.
I am Matthew Dolge. I'm the Executive Director of the Piedmont Triad Regional Council. July 1st of 2011, as you're aware, we merged the Piedmont Triad COG and the Northwest Piedmont COG to form the Piedmont Triad Regional Council, which serves the 12 counties of the Triad. We are in the process of trying to consolidate our staff, and that's why we're before you today. And I am fortunate to have Daryl Fry from Randolph County, who's our chair, and so I'll turn it over to him to make a presentation to you about our building.
Daryl, welcome to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, lady and gentlemen, Manager Honeycutt, thanks for having us tonight. It's a privilege to be here. If you might just indulge me for a moment, just sitting here and watching you, I caught myself almost voting on one of the motions a while ago. It's hard not to just say aye when you're so accustomed to doing that. But I just want to say one word about Alamance County and about the leadership that this county has had within our region for many years. It was my pleasure over 20 years ago to serve on the COG and on the State Board of County Commissioners with Junior Teague, and became a good friend of Junior's, and got to know him real well and have lots of memories. Also, during my tenure as chairman of the Piedmont Triad Partnership, the Burlington-Alamance County MSA, because the federal government changed the rules, you had a choice of joining the Research Triangle MSA or the Piedmont Triad MSA. And we lobbied you hard and successfully to be a part of our region. And you were very important then and even more so today. And I just appreciate your involvement. I serve with your chairman on the Park Board and with Commissioner Massey on the Regional Council. And you're well represented and well respected all across this region and throughout the state. And I just wanted to say that before I begin my sort of my official comments relative to why we're here tonight. The 12 counties, we merged our region G and Region I years ago when the COGs were first formed. We were at that time 11 county region. Montgomery has joined since then, but we were one region. Through politics and other issues, those COGs were split in 1978. And over every year, I've been on the COG board since 1982, and every other year, it comes up, why didn't we merge the COGs? And we successfully did that about 2 years ago. I came before your group at a meeting then to discuss the particulars of that merger. And one of the things that we promised as we went through those 12 counties was that we would be as centrally located as possible. If you can visualize, from Mebane to Yadkinville and from Dobson to Troy, it's a big area. And we wanted to be as centrally located, and geographically, that area is just south of Kernersville. And we have found a site there that would allow us to own our property. About 6 years ago, the North Carolina General Assembly passed rules that would allow councils of government to own property. We can't do it as an investment, we can't sublease, but we can own. Region G, prior to the merger, was having discussions about such an effort with our region to own our building. To give you just an example, and as specific as you want to be, we're looking at a 25,000 square foot facility. In that area near the airport, the lease is about $18 to $20 a square foot. The price to buy this 25,000 square foot designed our way. The building owner, the building contractor, allows us to design the floor plan. It's about a little over $14 a square foot. And that is a difference per month of $8,000 in savings to the COGs by doing that. In the last 10 years, the two COGs combined have paid out $2.6 million in rent And this will allow us again to own the property, have an asset that we will eventually pay for and have on our own and eliminate those costs. Part of this process established by the local government commission, they have asked us to come before each of the 12 counties for your approval. This doesn't commit you to anything. You're not bound by it. Doesn't affect your borrowing. They ask us to have a 70% approval. Of the 12 counties, 10 have already approved it. Alamance and Guilford are the only two counties that are left, and of course we're here tonight seeking your approval in that process. Again, so that you can be a part of it. We have, since the merger, we have reverted back to our old rates. Linda mentioned the benefits to this county. We've gone back to the old rates that we had when we were a single region GCOG. Some of that was accomplished by economies of scale as we've brought those two together. And we think that there's even more benefit to be gained by having everybody under one roof so that we have closer supervision and more direct control over the programs that the Council of Government is involved in. So that's the reason we're here tonight. As I said, there's no individual government liability in this. It doesn't commit your debt in any way. You are still free to withdraw from the Piedmont Triad Regional Council at any time that you choose under the terms of the bylaws, and that's the way it's always been. We resigned the written notice at the end of the current fiscal year. That hasn't changed. This borrowing is not tied to the dues that you pay or any commitment that you have as a member of this government. So that is the gist of why we're here. We think that, again, we can save money and have an asset and have that paid for and have a place for our own as we go forward. And that's the reason that we're here tonight. If you have specific questions, if you want to ask more questions about what the Council of Government does for Alamance County and your citizens, then Matthew and I will do our best to answer those questions for you also. So that's our reason for being here, Mr. Chairman, and be glad to answer questions as we can.
Thank you. Lynn, you want to comment?
No, I mean, I think it's well worth to build the building. We did look at several places. We went to in Kernersville even, and it would cost as much to renovate, if not more, to renovate that big building that we looked at to start with, and they had looked at several others. And we found that it was cheaper to go ahead and it's a lease to own to start with. I think that's the way it's going to work. But they will build this building, and we will own this building. And it's right outside. I have not rode over to see the spaceship, but I know it's right outside of Kernersville. Because we were going to Greensboro anyway.
Yep.
And they had two places that they were paying rent on. Yep. And one was in Winston, and one was in Greensboro. Yep. So the consolidation of all of the different counties that we have now, the 12 counties, it makes it easier for everybody to come to a central yes. place for our meetings. So.
And the reason for the lease arrangement is to allow this process to begin quicker while we go through the process of approval with the local government commission. This gives the builder assurance that we will occupy it, and it allows the construction process to begin as soon as we complete this process.
Is that the property across from Bishop McInnis?
It's beside Bishop McInnis.
So it is across.
Yeah. Oh, it is. It's between there and, yeah.
66
yes.
Like actually, the Cone Health facility is right across.
Right, there. Like you're going to Kearns.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm over there a lot. And you ever go to Clark's Barbecue, by the way?
Oh, yes. Yes, sir.
Trust me, I know where all those places are. Yeah, but that's right, south of the interstate, yeah. I believe.
Yes. That's yes. True. Just south of 40.
You know, there's a push out there amongst some citizens, and I don't disrespect them for having their sentiment, but a lot of people feel like, you know, it's a waste of money for cities to be in the League of Municipalities, which I frankly don't agree with that theory. I think they need to be there, whether I agree with what they stand for or not at all times. And County Commissioners Association, some people don't think we should be members of that. Some people don't think we should be members of the COG.
Yes.
You know, you've been, how long were you a county commissioner? Still there. You still there on the board?
I'm still there, yes.
All right.
How many? 30 years.
Have great respect for Randolph County's yes. Board of Commissioners.
Yes.
I would wonder who you think's more conservative. You or y'all or us?
That's our reputation. Always has been.
Yeah, of course it is. And Randolph County is a great county. But in the past, when y'all were here before, and we had a representative from the COG, you know, it's been my belief over the years that the Random and Dan probably would have never come to fruition without the COG's involvement.
Correct.
That's always been a belief of mine, and that's probably one of the most major accomplishments yes. that group got done. But I think what a lot of people locally would like to see is, you know, what I think there's a distribution of funds that has to come through. I don't know all the ins and outs of that, but what else can you cite? And I'm not asking this in a negative sense at all, but just for the sake of information, like what we know now about the Random and Dam project. What are some other things that we've benefited from in this district or region, or some of the things that you're working on currently that we'll benefit from?
I appreciate that. We always like the opportunity to kind of let folks know about some of these projects. And Random and Dam was a huge project and was driven largely by the efforts and coordinated by the efforts from Piedmont Tri-COG. And Randy Billings was a great driving force in that when Randy was the director. Another thing that we're actually dealing with now and working closely with Burlington and Durham and Greensboro. In fact, we've got a meeting coming up on the 8th that's trying to get modifications to help local governments with the Jordan Lake rules. And the Jordan Lake rules, as they were first written, were much more stringent, would have been much more costly for local governments. And again, the COG was a driving force in negotiating with the state, bringing the local governments to the table with the state to try to bring down the cost of those regulations and change those to help, you know, bring down the burden that we had on our local governments, which is a continuing process. I think that we're going to go back again and try to push back some of those issues with the Jordan Lake rules. A very immediate one we had here in the county, which wasn't specifically a county issue, we helped Burlington through our data center with their problems with the census this last time. I think it was pretty well publicized here when they came up and were just a few folks short of qualifying for a pretty good number of federal funds that would come through because they were just under 50,000 people. It was our staff, they were the ones who came in and redid the count, filed the appeal with the federal government, and got that number raised, and the appeal was brought forward. And so it helped Burlington, obviously, which is over a 10-year period, millions of dollars to folks here in this county that bring on new funding there. We do the RPO, which helps with transportation planning in our rural areas and the counties. We're continuing to work on water quality, workforce issues, obviously the aging issues, which I think most of you know about, all the things from in-home aid to Meals on Wheels to congregate nutrition, and all those types of programs are the ones that are coordinated with our aging staff. They help your folks plan and bring forward here in the county. So we think we have a pretty broad range of issues. We also do some direct consulting for you folks, and the county is using our Matt Reese to do personnel work and helping with pay and classification work and things like that here in the county. So, you know, what we try to do is facilitate things for the county. We're there when you need us, and hopefully when you ask us to do things, we can deliver a high quality service, do that for a very cost effective manner for you for professional services as well. So we feel good about those. What I've always told, and I was talking to one of our commissioners in Forsyth County, if we can't make the case for it for what we do and prove our worth and that we're adding value to the dollars that we bring in here, we don't deserve your vote and we don't deserve you to be members. And so I'm always happy to come and sit down with any of you and talk individually about programs specifically. And we do have others like small business loans and things like that we do. It's a pretty broad palette. And again, I'd love the opportunity to come up here anytime that you'd like to sit down individually and also talk to you about those programs.
They also do the workforce development program. Now, they've done it for all their members in Region I for years. We work together with you with Randolph, Alamance, and Orange, I believe it is,
yes.
In Regional Consolidated Services.
I go to that too, by the way.
Yeah. Yeah. So we've had lots of things in common. The COG did our land use plan. They wrote our zoning ordinance, and they've done our original pay classification plan, and they've updated that for us three or four times over the years. So you mentioned my service. I was sworn into office in December of 1982, and that day when we reorganized the board, they brought up the representative for the Council of Government. And They said, well, they meet over in Greensboro. And they said, don't you work in High Point? And I said, yeah. And they said, well, you'll be good. So they penciled me in. So I've been on this cog as long as I've been a county commissioner. I was appointed to serve, and I've served on a number of boards, but there's none that I have any more respect for and feel that if we ever got value for the dollars that we spend, it's through this council of government. And there's no waste. It too is managed very conservatively. We have a lot of conservative local governments that make that board up, and they've always seen to that. A lot of the problems that have occurred out in the East, they would never happen here in the Piedmont Triad. And we run a good ship. We don't spend money that we don't have to. We watch our budget very tightly. And the members run that. I know in a lot of these organizations, the directors just take over and they tell everybody what to do. But the members here have a tremendous influence over what takes place.
Did Forsyth or Winston-Salem just pull out a few months ago?
No. They came in originally. Only Guilford didn't come in originally at the merger, and they joined about a year ago or earlier this year.
Yeah, okay. It was Guilford County.
Darrell, I received this in the mail, and I'm wondering if you sent it, or did everybody
get
one of
these? Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this is like a summary report of those activities
that
Darrell and Matthew were describing, and it's pretty thorough. And. Yeah. Our own Linda Massey is not only on the committee, but on the executive committee as well.
She's been on executive committee.
You've been on it for what, 3 years?
Well, not only then, when I was on the council and the mayor of Hall River, I was also on the COG. So they were happy when I came back on the COG as county commissioner. So everybody was like, hey, we're glad you're back here.
She's
so,
very loyal in her attendance. You always have a voice.
Let me ask you this, Darrell. Under the rules and the approval that you said was necessary, 10 of the 12 have approved, and you're talking to us tonight. Do you have a scheduled vote for Guilford, or have they already
voted? They wanted to wait till, as you know, they've gone through quite a reorganization.
Okay, so
their board was reduced from 11 to 9, and we think this month they're going to bring it up.
And what is required for your board to continue the process? Do you have to have 12 out of 12?
No, the local government commission said 70%, and so we're there. We set for ourselves 100%. We want to have everybody acknowledges that you were presented with the specifics and that you voted.
And 70% of the
12 counties.
But not based on population within the county, just each county is equal.
It is by population. We're actually where we need to be currently. Again, we're an organization that's built on consensus, and I think our board felt strongly that it was important to have everybody involved in this process and not simply make it a matter of math. Quite frankly, we want everybody to feel like they had a voice in this, and that's why we're going to all of our members.
Quite frankly here, I'm almost positive you received a letter early on in this process from a High Point City Council person. One of the sites that we considered was in fact in High Point. We would have only owned or rented one floor of a multi-story building and didn't feel that was in the long-term best interest of the council. They thought that should have stayed a priority. There was also a builder from Guilford County who was in had another location. So there's a little bit other than just the issues related to what we've discussed here tonight that's been involved in that Guilford County process.
I have a problem with this expansion. It looks to me like it's another expansion of a governmental agency. This time, I just not in favor of that.
Other comments?
Do you do any type of recruiting for jobs or industry, or do you help with that? Or
we have a data center that actually run in Region G at the time. But if you have an economic development project here, all the demographics of this region are available, and most of I know ours does, and I'm pretty sure yours does. They get that information through the Council of Government relative to populations, job availability, the infrastructure, all of those issues are kept current and managed through the COG. We don't do recruitment, and we don't work with, we would supply that same information to a potential client.
Right.
But we don't sit down and make incentive deals and that sort of thing.
We see our job as really be a facilitator from that standpoint. You know, the state put the Piedmont Tribe Partnership and the Economic Development Partnerships in charge of recruitment, and quite frankly, we don't want to spend our money to duplicate services that they provide. That's not a smart use of money. But what we can do is in areas like with workforce, small business loans, grant writing, utilities and things like that, try to facilitate projects when they are coming down the pipe. And so, you know, again, we try to be that value added to help move projects along or to help local governments be more competitive in their search for employment. And certainly through on-the-job training and grant programs and things like that, we're trying to help employers in the private sector have the resources when they're ready to bring folks into new jobs.
Mr. Chair, I just wanted to clarify one thing Matt said. I believe we have done paying class studies in the past. We're not currently doing one now, but I just wanted you to be aware of that.
Thank you, Greg. If there are no more questions, is there a motion for adoption of the resolution supporting the Piedmont Triad Regional Council Building Acquisition Project?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Record show motion passed 3-2. Thank you all for being there.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you.
See you at Clark's.
Well, we didn't get any hot dogs or barbecue from them, so let's see what our accountants can do. At this time, we are going to receive the report from our external accountant. We have two pieces of information in front of us. We have the actual audit. Each of you should have a copy of the audit. And then there's a summary, which I believe we're also going to see in the form of a PowerPoint. And is Crystal here? Crystal, welcome to present the 2012 Comprehensive Annual Financial Report of Alamance County.
Thank you so much for having me tonight. Again, my name is Crystal Waddell, and I'm from Martin Starnes and Associates, and we perform your annual financial statement audit. So I'm here tonight to discuss the results of your June 30th, 2012 audit. The Local Government Commission has approved the county's report, and I brought books also. So in front of you, you have your audited financial statements. We issued an unqualified opinion, which is the highest level of opinion the county can receive, meaning there are no financial statement findings and there are no compliance findings related to your federal and state grants. And at this time, I would like to thank Amy and Susan and the entire finance department for all of their hard work and cooperation during our audit process. A little bit about our audit process. We start in the spring, where we perform our risk assessments and we test your internal controls over your major systems. And at that time, we also start testing your federal and state grants. We come back in the fall where we concentrate on your year-end balances. And of course, the final product is your audited financial statements. So for us, this is a year-round process. Here are your general fund revenues and expenditures in comparison to prior year. Revenues came in at $123 million, which is an increase over prior year. Expenses came in at $124 million, which is a decrease over prior year. So after transfers and long-term debt issued, your general fund had an increase to fund balance of $2.5 million, bringing total fund balance at year-end to $21.6 million. The Local Government Commission considers available fund balance to be an important number for all units in North Carolina. It first represents what you as the board can appropriate in your next fiscal year's budget. It is also a tool that the Local Government Commission uses to gauge your available fund balance to others of your size. To get to available fund balance, you take your total general fund balance, you subtract out non-spendable fund balance, and you subtract out stabilization by state statute. All of these numbers can be found on Exhibit C in your audit report. Your total available fund balance came in at $14 million. which was an increase over prior year.
Crystal, can you stop there and tell us what stabilization by state statute really means?
Stabilization by state statute is a state law that requires you to restrict the amount of cash minus liabilities minus deferred revenue, which is your prepaid taxes, minus encumbrances at year end. So that calculation is state required, and it toggles off of total fund balance, those items that I mentioned, which are your year-end balance sheet items. The local government commission then takes your available fund balance and divides it by your general fund expenditures to come up with a percentage. And your available percent was a little over 11% in 2012, which was also a slight increase compared to prior year. Now I want to stop there and recap, because my first four slides show positive results for your general fund. Your revenues increased over prior year. Your expenditures decreased over prior year. General fund balance increased by 2.5, increasing your available fund balance and slightly increasing this percentage. However, the local government commission is no longer solely looking at your fund balance available in relation to that 8% minimum that they recommend. They are also now looking at your available fund balance in comparison to statewide averages and your peer group average based on population. The 2012 average statistics are not available because those results are still coming in and being compiled. So we have to reference the 2011 statistics. In 2011, the statewide average fund balance available was 23.4%, and your peer group based on population was 22.01%. So if you look at this slide in consideration to those numbers I just read you, the local government commission has looked at your fund balance and issued a unit letter in 2012. And a unit letter simply states that the local government commission is concerned with your available fund balance, and they have requested a response in writing within 30 days, and that response would be once you and management get together to come up with a plan to increase that available fund balance to a LGC acceptable number. Also on your letter, when you get a chance to read it, the local government commission went one step further this year, and they are discussing restricted cash in that letter. Your restricted cash in your general fund at year end represents unspent debt proceeds and unspent grant proceeds. And the reason the local government commission mentioned this in their letter is because they consider those items unavailable for appropriation. Unspent debt proceeds are earmarked for capital related purposes or whatever the purpose was in which you issued the debt. Unspent grant proceeds at year end are already earmarked for those grant related purposes. And so when they took out restricted cash from this calculation, it drops your available fund balance down to even a lower number that they mentioned in your letter. And so I did want to mention that, and I've discussed this with Amy and Craig, and I'm available to discuss it further with you via email or phone call. Amy and Craig both have my information when the time comes that you get together with management, if you need further explanation on where they're getting those numbers or the exact calculation for stabilization by state statute. I have all that stuff and can further explain.
Was it the 8% a state statute?
The 8% is a recommended minimum. The local government commission recommended minimum. It's not a requirement. The local government commission considers 8% to be 1 month's worth of expenditures, meaning if at June 30th revenues were to cut off, a fund balance could float its expenditures for 1 month if you had 8% available fund balance.
But was that per state statute, or is that just an independent?
It is just a, yeah, it's just a state recommended based on the LGC's 8% benchmark, but not a requirement and not state law.
Crystal, would you go back to page 7? I think it's just one back. Yeah, right there.
Okay.
So we ended the year with 14 million, and that's where you got the percent of, 11.2%. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. So what would that number have to be under the new rules to where we would no longer have the pleasure of getting these letters that you're talking about?
You're going to put me on the spot and make me do math in my head. Well, let's try to calculate it here. If we are at 11% and your average is 22 for your peer group, you could almost double that. So
$28 million.
Mm-hmm. And that's just available fund balance.
That's all right. We don't need to get that. That's all right, Barry. And these rules were changed just this year?
Well, they've always posted the statistics, so I can't say the rules have changed. They are moving towards solely looking at the 8% and only sending a letter as you approach that 8% to focusing also on comparing you to your statewide averages and your peer group. I can't say that they've never done it in the past, but they're putting more emphasis on that way to gauge your fund balance available versus solely looking at the 8%.
And the $28 million or so, was that the state average or was that the peer average? That was the peer average.
Yeah, the state average is 23.4 and the peer average is 22.01.
Isn't there a chart in here of those counties?
There is not, but Amy does have that information.
Yeah, we had it in the past. I'm not trying to justify it, I'm just giving you my opinion, though. This peer group comparison, I would contend that it's the fact that they're so much higher is excessive taxation versus only taxing as you go and paying as you go. I would charge that in a heartbeat. Let me give you an example. Davidson County had reevaluation, didn't cut their taxes one penny after reval. Now that happens. And that caused a massive increase in their fund balance. And when we were, Tim Burgess and I were down there talking to the assistant county manager about budget performance-based budgeting. That's why we were there. And I just asked him in a meeting, I said, how did you, because I knew what their fund balance was. And theirs is one of them that has that high percentage. They didn't cut their taxes at all. And I asked him, I said, how did you do that? I said, they would have burnt our courthouse down had we pulled that stunt. And he just sat back and grinned. But there's countless stories of where the fund balances are excessive in counties, and it's because of excessive taxation versus spend as you go, pay as you go, and only taking as much as needed to operate an efficient government. With as a result, your fund balance develops to a certain point. But I don't buy that peer group comparison as much as some would like for us to buy into. And Davidson County is a perfect example of why theirs is so high.
On the same statistics that I keep referring to, you can also check out tax rates. And so you can gauge what their fund balance available percentage is in comparison to their tax rate for everyone in your peer group.
Right.
That's a good link to look at. You can go to the state treasurer's website and click on county and municipality fiscal information. There's a link named something to that effect. And you can click on your county, and then you can click on and compare to others. It's a pretty useful tool. And I believe Amy has that actually with her.
Okay. Crystal, now back to page 5. Under the old rules, when we were looking at that 8% trough, during this year, we actually increased the fund balance by over $2.5 million. I'm reading that right?
Correct.
Okay. But then, do the new rules apply when you go over to page 7 and see that the available fund balance has only increased $200,000?
Let me kind of explain that. Your fund balance did increase by $2.5 million. Therefore, your total fund balance came in at the 21.6.
Right.
However, when you get over to your available fund balance, this slide really breaks it down. Out of your total fund balance, 7.5 is unavailable for appropriation because it's restricted by state statute. and then 172,000 of it is unavailable for appropriation because those are prepaid items. They're not in spendable form. And so out of your 21.6 million, 14 is only available for appropriation.
Okay. The amounts in that stabilization, can they not be somewhat managed by staff so that at June 30th the account can make up that formula or minimized a little bit?
I've sent a pretty lengthy email to Amy, and I believe she's forwarded it on to Craig.
We can forward that to you.
Stabilization by state statute can be monitored, but it's very difficult to control in practice. One of the factors of stabilization by state statute is your liabilities, your AP on hand at year end. Well, from an operations standpoint, a practical standpoint, you can't cut off, it just would not work to cut off all your POs and invoices in March just to be able to receive all of your invoices and pay them before June 30th. The flip side of that is once you pay them, if that was feasible, if you paid them by June 30th, then your cash decreases. And cash is also a factor of stabilization by state statute, so it's a wash.
Do we have, Craig, the letters that Crystal's talking about in here?
A copy of the LGC letter was placed in front of your place.
That's in that other stack.
Yes, let me ask you this. You keep harping on this $14 million as the fund balance, but this letter says our real fund balance is $9,660,000 or 7.83%. Why do we keep talking about $14 million when that is what the state treasurer here, the LGC, is saying they are concerned about?
The available fund balance calculation is $14 million in these percentages. The local government commission has went one step further, and this goes back to the restricted cash I was talking about that was on hand at year end. When you back out that restricted cash
that
from
means
this,
that money is designated for something else.
Correct.
So that is not available to us to spend.
Correct.
And what but they're saying is $9,660,000 is our fund balance. And it comes out 7.83%, right?
It is your fund balance available without restricted cash. Your fund balance available for appropriation is $14 million. Minus restricted cash, it is the $9
million. And it
comes
out to the $9,660,000, right?
Yes.
Other questions for Crystal, or for Craig, or for Amy, or for Susan?
I do want to say, and number one, I want to thank Crystal and our finance department for the work that they've done to get us to this point. The positive thing about this, I think we need to make sure we're focusing on, is we're in the black this year. For the last 3-4 years, we have not been in the black. So even though it's not by a greater percentage than what we would hope for, and actually the percentages have changed and moved down, we still did end up in the black, and that does go a lot to all our departments as well, because we've cut expenditures greatly, and I appreciate the work that we've done as far as departments and cutting expenditures, but also appreciate the work that we've done to try to maximize our revenues. So it really has been a team effort. It's been slow, but again, at least we're in the black this year compared to the last 2 or 3 years.
Well, that's right, Craig, and your swing, if you go back to Crystal's bar graph on page 4, you can see your total swing is what, $5 million?
Yes, sir.
Your revenues are up by 3.8, your expenses are down by 1.7, mm-hmm. So that's close to $5 million swing.
Yes, sir.
In 1 year. That is I believe that in hearing your audit report, the board must have a motion to accept the audit report. Is that correct?
Yes.
Crystal, do you have anything to add?
We have the landfill fund?
We do. We have one more slide.
Yeah, we have a couple more slides.
I'll wrap up with the landfill. And this is your landfill fund. And you can see that the landfill in 2012 had operating income of $198,000, which was an increase over prior year. Total net assets came in at $18.9 million, and net assets in an enterprise business type fund is the equivalent of fund balance. So you can see your income increased and your fund you actually added to fund balance or net assets. And I will end there, and I can take any more questions.
Well, I will congratulate Greg. leave that slide on for a minute. There, Greg, look at it. Y'all worked a great job.
We can get it.
If you haven't seen the landfill, everybody needs to go see the landfill.
That's right.
Now, thank you, Crystal. Is there a motion to accept the formal report of the financial condition of Alamance County as of June 30th, 2012?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
A second.
Thank you, Linda. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Crystal.
Thank you for having me. Have a good night.
Mr. Chairman, I do want to mention in response to the LGC, we will be working with Crystal and our finance department and bringing you back a letter at our next meeting for recommendation for you to approve, and so that we can send on it as a response back to the local government commission to meet their deadline.
What is their deadline?
It's 30 days. So our next... Our next meeting is the 17th?
No, January
22nd. We'll let the LGC know that we're not meeting again till the 22nd, and I'm sure it won't be a problem. But we'll have a response ready for you. And if you have specific questions or concerns or if we can get additional information for you before that, please let us know.
Thank you, Greg. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chris.
We now have a budget amendment from our health department chair, who is not very healthy this evening. Barry, would you like to join us?
Thank you, sir.
For a budget amendment number 49.
Yes, sir. And I was looking at the description. It said landfill on here, so I might want to think I have some. Greg needed some more money, but anyway, $1,500 is the amount of the grant that. Our agency has been offered, and this is from the National Association of Boards of Health, NALBO, and this is for a training activity that would involve a Board of Health member, Kathy Coville, and myself. And what we will be doing is learning how to be mentors and go to other health departments in regards to what is called the Community Guide from NALBO. And as you all know, Alamance County has embedded as part of our practice looking at evidence-based practices and doing the kinds of things to work towards efficiencies and effectiveness in terms of how we deliver services and have programs that are evidence-based. So in doing that, that will be part of what we will be doing is having a going out to another county board of health and county health department where their folks and their board of health and talking about evidence-based practices and the community guide. So this $1,500 is basically an educational stipend in order to cover our training expenses in order to participate in this program. We were one of four health departments in North Carolina who were selected for this, and we're very honored that we were chosen, and would hope that you all agree and would allow us to move forward with it.
How does this benefit Alamance County?
Well, first of all, it shows how a good a job that we're doing in terms of providing services and programs that are evidence-based that show that they're going to have an outcome. I know certainly in conversation with Commissioner Sutton, we talk about the kinds when you do something that you're able to show on the other end that there's been a benefit of us having done it. So that would benefit our county in that. I think basically we're showing that we're doing it right. That we are providing the kinds of services that are beneficial and to help other departments do the same kind of thing.
So what you're saying is this grant is to send one of our people to a class, I guess, to learn how to go to other health departments to show them what we've been doing or what they should be doing?
Educate us on how to be able to teach the mentorship program. So it's an educational process for
mentoring other health.
That is correct. Yes, sir. That is correct. And it would involve one of our Board of Health members, Kathy Coville, and myself.
Barry did point out, Tori, we probably need to change the topic. It does say landfill at the top. We probably need to change that if this is approved. Other questions for Barry? If not, is there a motion to approve budget amendment number 49 in the amount of $1,500?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all, and Merry Christmas to everyone.
Thank you.
I hope Santa Claus comes to see you.
He was Santa Claus.
I know he was.
At the Board of Health.
People don't know that.
He was
Thank
good.
You, Barry.
He
Thank
was
you
really
Barry,
good.
For sharing. 9A, Commissioner Smith requested that we review the Community Services Block Grant application. I assume Jason,
Wendy Covington is here.
Oh, Wendy. Hey, Wendy.
This is a grant that has no fiscal impact to the county. It's just something we do have to approve. We're not the fiscal agent, but since it is a county grant and it's a federal grant, I think we just have to approve it. So Wendy's here to answer any questions.
We'll let Commissioner Smith begin the...
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
You wish to pull this one off of consent?
Yeah, I want to know what it is.
Hi, good
evening.
Let me
ask you this first. Jason, is this the same thing as the old CDBG grant?
Jason removed himself just a few minutes.
Oh, he did? Oh, okay.
No, sir, it's not the Community Development Block Grant.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So just explain to me exactly what it is. And
sure.
Because I've read most of this stuff, and I did not get a good handle on it.
No problem. Alamance County Community Services Agency is one of 36 community action agencies in the state of North Carolina, and this is the Community Service Block Grant Funds. And the majority of the CAP agencies, community action agencies, receive these dollars to provide services that would help to eliminate poverty issues in the county. And this is basically our anti-poverty plan, and our plan will cover the next 2 years. And in this plan, we are hoping that we're able to provide services to constituents, low-income constituents in Alamance County that would help them to find jobs, place them in affordable housing, help with education services, financial management services, as well as other training services, too. The agency will have a staff of 8 individuals in this particular program, and the program is called the Self-Sufficiency Program. And with a budget of $252,152, we're hoping that we're able to provide a comprehensive case management services to help citizens to become independent, economically independent, that is. Part of the anti-poverty plan requires that we get comments and suggestions from members of the in the community, as well as you all as well. If you have any comments or recommendations, we certainly would like to hear that and include that in our plan. We also involve other providers in the community, including Alamance Community College, including the Department of Social Services as well, and in order that we are able to meet our goals. We feel like we cannot provide this service or help meet these goals without including the partnering agencies in the county as well. But tonight, we just want to make sure that you do not have any comments or recommendations regarding the plan. If there's anything that we need to include in the plan, we have involved constituents, their input. We did a series of community meetings in the county. We had a public hearing as well to include comments and suggestions from individuals in the community. So if you have any comments, recommendations, we certainly would be willing to entertain that tonight.
Is this state money or federal money through the state?
It's federal monies that's funneled down through the state.
And no department of the county is involved. Is that what you said?
No one is involved. It's just part of our grant administrator wants us to make sure that you all are aware of this plan and that you support it as well.
And you have a board of directors?
We do. We have a board
of... Who appoints those board of directors, Wendy?
Who appoints them? Our board, of course, is appointed by the members of the of our board, the nominating committee, of course. And the board's actually makeup is from various entities in the county. Sherry is one of our board members as well.
I saw the list. I just didn't know who appointed them. Your nominating committee nominates?
Yeah, they nominate members from the community to be on our board.
And how many employees do you have?
We have about 17 individuals that are employed in our agency. Our board is made up of the poor community as well as the private and public community. So individuals from those communities represent our board.
Thank you.
Can you give us some success stories of some clientele? And
sure. Well, we have several success stories, but one that come into mind is an individual who actually was a Work First recipient who came and volunteered at our agency, and she became a participant of our self-sufficiency program. We were able to assist her to find a full-time job. She began working, and from there, she was able to obtain her own vehicle. She did not have transportation at the time when she came to us. We were able to assist her with finding her own car, as well as she began saving monies, and now she's a homeowner as well, and she is still employed. This individual has been working for the past 3 years, as a matter of fact, and she still actually volunteers for the agency from time to time.
Ms. Osborne, where is she at? Do you see any overlap at all, or is this pretty good tandem process agency with your agency?
We do. We do lots of referrals to community services. They provide also the winterization for homes in Alamance County. So that's one program out of the Federal Energy Fund that has to be provided, and community services receives those funds. She was talking about the Work First representative. That was actually Work First client. That was actually our client receiving the Work First check, or the, you know, the public assistance check. So we do a lot of referral. We contracted with them for many years to run the Wheels to Work program with some of our ROAP funds and TANF employment funds.
Is the total budget more than the $200,000+?
Yes.
What is your
Our total budget is $1.5 million. And Susan is correct. We do have various services that we provide. The Community Service Block Grant is just one of many services that we provide. Of course, Linda's familiar with our Congregate Meals program, which serves area senior citizens daily by providing a lunch to them at five sites located throughout Alamance County, and the weatherization program, as well as we provide emergency assistance with food, utility assistance. We also provide assistance with affordable housing. We have two subdivisions that's located in the county, so we also build homes. One of those subdivisions we're in partnership with the city of Burlington with.
Other questions for Wendy? We had this item pulled from consent agenda, so we now do need to vote on accepting or approving the Community Services Block Grant application. Is there a motion to accept the block grant application?
So moved.
Second.
Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
The minutes reflect passage 3-2.
Thank you,
Wendy.
So much.
Okay, 9A, that was 9A. Number 10, adoption of the commissioners 2013 meeting schedule and proposed committee assignments. Commissioners, you have actually three pieces of paper in front of you relating to this topic. One of the one of the pieces of paper that you have is for information only. It is not really part of the meeting. That is the invocation schedule. That is just for your information. However, we do have the regular meeting schedule. If we can take a look at that first, I'd just like to make a couple of comments and then let Craig comment or anybody. Based on the time of year and work, we typically have not had a first Monday January meeting. The schedule here reflects that, which would make our next meeting on Tuesday, January 22nd, the Tuesday scheduled instead of the Monday the 21st due to the Martin Luther King holiday being on that Monday. The other dates here are the first and third Mondays, other than the September 3rd meeting is on Tuesday due to the Labor Day holiday on Monday, September 2nd. And I believe there is only one July meeting scheduled for July 15th, but not a meeting on the first Monday of July.
Yes, sir.
Greg?
Yes, sir.
Commissioners, any comments or feedback? This is a draft, and we can certainly take it back for any further consideration.
During the campaign, I had an awful lot of comments from senior citizens saying they were not able to come to meetings because they're always in at night, and a lot of seniors don't like to drive at night and don't like to get out at night. So for about 60 years or so, we had the first meeting in each month on Monday mornings. I'd like at some point for the panel to consider going back to that. I just find it inconvenient to hold all of the meetings at night. But there's no motion. I don't have any problem with this otherwise, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Dave. I would like to ask you guys that were here during that time what the thought process was on
switching. I don't know why we switched, to be honest with you.
I don't know why we switched either.
In all honesty, I can't work at night. So I miss work when I have to come here, but my obligation is here. So I would like to go back to having a 9 o'clock. It was what it was. It was the first meeting in Monday, and it's first Monday in the month. And the third Monday, one was at night and one was in the morning, 9 and 7. And I don't know why, in all honesty, I don't know what switch. And I hate waiting all day for the blasted meeting when I'm in town. So I'd like to go back to at least one 9 o'clock.
I'll make a motion that we go back to the 9 o'clock meeting as the first Monday in each month.
I'll second it.
That's good. I'll make more money. I can work.
Great. We don't want to keep you from working.
Do you have any... logistical concerns with doing that?
We just have to make sure we let the court system know that we have first priority in this room, so it shouldn't be a problem at all.
We also need to make sure that if we do that, it doesn't conflict with any committee meetings. I'm not aware of any Monday morning committee meetings, but there may be some that you guys are on.
At this point, we don't see any problems, but if there is, we'll let you know.
Okay, well, the motion is by Commissioner Smith that the first meeting of the month would be a 9 o'clock Monday morning meeting in this room.
Yes.
And there was a second from Bill. That would, if passed, would start with the February 4th meeting, and that the January meeting is only the second meeting, which is the third Monday.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other discussion or questions about that before we ask for a vote? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, sir. Okay, now, so I should have asked you to amend your motion to approve the meeting schedule as a whole.
So moved.
Would you do that? Is there a second to that?
Second.
And all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. The second piece of information there is the committee assignments. Again, this is a draft. I talked to Tori a little bit about this, and also to Craig. And what we tried to do was everybody that was on a committee who didn't express a desire to get off the committee was pretty much left on the committees that you were last year. David, we assigned the three there to you that Commissioner Boswell had been on, I believe. Tori, is that right? And the one that we didn't hook you into, but you're welcome to volunteer for.
I feel it coming.
Liaison to the school board. And let me comment about that. that is not an official, unlike a lot of the boards that we serve on, we may be ex officio, in some case we're voting members. None of that's the case with the school board, and we have our new chairman with us. Tony, congratulations to you. But basically, it was used as a kind of a communication tool. Commissioner Boswell did attend. He didn't attend at every meeting, but he was there and brought back information. I can tell you they meet along, and sometimes it's not even fun.
Tony's going
to. Yeah, well, that's true. So gotcha. I throw that out for you to think about, and actually our county manager also.
I'll think about that.
Okay, think about that, and our county manager volunteered to attend some meetings. I think it is important.
Maybe we could alternate then, Greg.
Well, I'll be glad to. Yes, sir.
So rather than make that an official committee assignment, we'll just have it for discussion. It is important. We've got a lot of conversations that will be coming up with the school system, particularly during budget season. I'm optimistic, and I feel real good about what y'all have done over there, and we're excited to work with you.
I do too, Tony. So, really pleased.
So if we leave that off, commissioners, and does everything else look about like it needs to from either where you were or what you want to do or where we want to go from here? And I'm go ahead, I'm sorry.
I'm happy to have six committees, by the way, on this board.
We're happy for you, Linda.
I love it.
You want some more?
And I don't know that we need a motion for approval. These are just assignments that folks have made. If you do have questions or comments or anything changes on the committee, let Tori know and she can update that. But in the absence of that, let's go ahead and remove the draft from these two documents and get that out to everybody. Very good. And thank you, Tori, for working on that. Next item 11, again, this is just kind of a brief update on the performance evaluations. We are now we have a final draft of a document that can be used for the three positions that report directly to the board. This is not distributed, this is one I brought from last time. It's for the positions of county manager, county attorney, and tax administrator. For the two positions, county manager and county attorney, I would like to suggest that since it is the end of the calendar year, at least, that perhaps Tori could send out this form by email to everyone, and we could use that to complete for not only. Let me just. There's a couple things I want to say. It's a performance tool, but it also is an opportunity to talk about goals and objectives for the upcoming period. And the very last page of that has the measurable goals for executive employee, which would be the two. This would be kind of our starting point for them to list kind of what they think their accomplishments have been, plus their job responsibilities. And maybe the thing to do is have you two guys complete that and send it to us.
We'd be glad to.
That would be you and Clyde.
Right.
And the other one will be addressed in a little different fashion. And then why don't you do that, say, by the January 22nd meeting?
Yes, sir.
And then we will have maybe 30 days to get our comments together. We could sit down, and that will be right before budget season and kind of the new year gets going in full swing, the new calendar year.
Yes, sir.
Is that agreeable?
Sure.
Everybody? Okay, so don't lose this document then.
Yes, sir.
And we'll expect it. What I would suggest is that you send it to each of us via email, and this is a personnel document.
Right. So yes, sir.
Okay. We'll
put confidential on.
All right. Any other comments about that? That's really all I wanted to say about that. If not, we'll turn to the county manager's report. Craig?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Sorry, it's my old hush.
Okay. Wait.
No, this is me. One minute, if we can. Every time you bring it. What we wanted to bring up and discuss with you tonight is Grand Manor. And as the board's aware, we purchased the property in 2009, and it basically is set there. And we have done minor maintenance on it, and we have spent to this point Between June 30th, 2009, and now approximately $8,000 just on minor repairs. However, it's getting beyond the minor repair stage as far as the roof. And we do have some pictures. Here we can go over, you know, just some bullet points now. Details of the property. Again, investment to date is about $8,000 for tree removal, cleanup, debris removal, and we have boarded up some of the windows. But again, the major issues we're having right now is the roof is leaking and leaking very badly, and it's causing additional damage. And also, we're having problems with building security. A lot of the windows have been broken out. We boarded up some of the windows, but not all of them have been boarded up. And Richard is here as well, and Brian, and I appreciate the work that they have done on this. But we've looked at the possibility of a total fix on the roof and put a new flat membrane roof with a 10-year warranty is $56,000. If we wanted to just patch the roof, and that's the existing holes that we have now, it doesn't mean any additional holes that may come next week. But just to patch the holes in the roof is $4,760. That'll give you a warranty for 1 year. And then we would need $2,000 to look at boarding, you know, the cost for boarding up all the windows in the building. Again, there has been discussion about demolition. On April 30th of this year, we received a cost estimate from D.H. Griffin. Between $150,000 and $180,000 for demolition. And again, we really haven't done a full asbestos study of it, so that cost may come down. The $150,000 to $180,000 was worst case scenario. So where we're at now, we've been able to maintain the building with Richard's funds and maintenance. But now it's getting to the point where we're going to have to do some major expenditures one way or the other, and that's the reason why we wanted to bring it back to the board for your direction. And again, here's some of the pictures that you can see that are caused by the leakage. And next. And there's the roof as well.
Is it on the historical registry, Craig? It is.
Demolition is possible despite is being on the national historic status. So we can demolish if necessary, but it is listed, but there's no problem with demolition.
Brian, has anybody from the Historical Society shown any interest in this building?
No, sir. We've talked with, we checked with Senator Graham. Apparently it's not on Graham's local district. The building is not in Graham's local district. It is on it's a contributing structure to a national historic district up on that end of North Main Street. But we haven't had any direct conversation with anyone from a historic interest about trying to do that.
I talked to Jason briefly before the meeting about it and asked if there was some kind of grants that he could apply for or the county could apply for that might help with infrastructure to save it to a point. At some point, we may be able to do something with it, Brian.
One issue we found in the past about applying for those kind of grants, I'm sure Jason can speak to this. If you apply for state or federal funds to renovate it, you have to go by Department of Interior standards, and it will make it extremely expensive. Sometimes it's difficult to find capital monies to go in and fix these kind of buildings because they hold you to a very high historic standard. And most times the federal government and state is reluctant to fund that kind of construction. It's not impossible, but it's really expensive to fix it to that standard. So.
Well, we don't have $150,000 now to tear it down, so you saying, what, $6,000 to fix the roof?
Well, if the board was agreeable, we do have some funds available in our capital projects fund. The balance now is?
The current balance. After we've completed the work at Rescue, and we've also completed the recent work over criminal courts, where you guys remember we moved monies from the balance of facility improvement over into the Capital Building Fund. Our current balance, best of my records, is $332,635 that can't be spent on capital projects.
So, what is it, about 3.5 acres?
Yes, sir.
We already own 2.5 acres there, too, don't we?
Yes, sir. It's a little over 3 acres, yes, sir. But a little over two additional with the...
5 or 6 acres, too. That's a big tract.
That's right, with the Sammy Epps building.
Yeah, the Sammy Epps.
did you mention, in terms of tearing it down, did you mention if we had help tearing it down? Like a practice session for the firefighters?
We've not approached Graham or see that. I'm sure we'd have to remove the asbestos. There'd still be a cost on that, so we haven't had that looked at, but that may be a possibility as well. But you'd still have a cost of removing the debris.
Well, there's really a cost to do anything.
Right. But if the board is saying demolish, then what we would do is go back and find the cheapest and most efficient way to look at the demolition, and we would see if it would be a good training tool for fire departments as well, or if there was any interest.
I personally hate to lose the building, but if it's getting to the point that it's cheaper to raise it than to keep on pouring money. Of course, we haven't poured much at $8,000 since 2009. It's not a lot.
Well, is there something you have to do within like the next 30 days or we're in like really, really trouble?
It's just getting worse. I guess that's the reason why it's to the point where it's getting bad. It's getting worse every day. And it's one of those things that if we decide that we're going to fix the roof, you know, and put the $50,000, that we need to probably address immediately. Because if we address it immediately, you know, then less damage would occur, you know, in the future.
But look what we're fixing. I mean, this...
That's the reason why we want to come back and get direction. Is again, it's beyond where maintenance can handle it. It's beyond where Richard's budget can absorb and say, we're going to put a couple of $1,000 in to fix some minor holes. It's beyond.
Well, let me ask Richard, without putting you on the spot, what would you do?
Tear it down.
That's what I would do also.
So, I mean, there's no realistic way that you can put the building back in a condition it can be used. And even if you had deep pockets and wanted to do so, you still have a lot of non-functioning space. The building's very shallow. It looks big from the road. There's really no space in it but hallways and a few classrooms. And to go back and try to put this back, even from a historical standpoint, you'd have nothing but the shell of the building that would remain. To try to index on projects we have done, some of the historical buildings that we have renovated, historical courthouse, the old DSS building, which is now Family Justice, on a scale of 1 to 10, I would tell you those buildings structurally were 6s and 7s. This is a 2. So exponential cost to go back and put it back to a working condition. The two wings, which were added sometime, we think back in the 30s and 40s, are actually in worse shape than the original building. It's in bad shape. The holes that Craig are talking about have happened every time. The water is coming straight through the building. So when it rains, you're now getting inches of water both on the first floor and the second floor.
Is there a basement, Richard?
There is a basement. It's not full. There's multi-sectional basements. Originally, that housed the old coal fire burners. Craig's got a picture when he started up. That was the actual basement. But this right here just kind of gives you an idea. When it rains, this is what Buddy and I walk into a few days later. This is the residual dirt from the roof that came into the building when it rained. So it's coming through the rubber membrane. It's going through the original ceiling in the building, which is your old typical 12 by 12 Sealitex. Then there was a drop ceiling under that was put in when it was used as Grand Manor. Straight holes through to the floor.
Will it stand until our next meeting?
Oh, sure. Oh, sure.
Then why don't we ask the manager to give us an idea about the destruction?
Well, if The board is interested. What probably the recommendation would be is we can get some truer figures, but probably part of that is we need somebody to do us an asbestos abatement plan and see how much that would cost. We could then approach the fire departments and look at different options. And once we get a better handling on the asbestos, is we can give you a truer figure on the demolition. But what would you say the asbestos?
About
3,000. Yeah, just we'd have to do that anyway.
Yeah. What would our liability be if somebody got hurt there or something happened?
Our insurance, isn't it? Great, wouldn't it?
We have tried to seal. You know, there's some security issues there. Richard can tell you better than I. There's been beer and graffiti, beer bottles, graffiti. So it's being used as a hangout now.
Yeah.
So it's one of those things. Also, we know that there's a liability there, you know, and you know, we have to do everything we can to secure it since we know that there could be a danger.
Well, you know, back when we approved this, you know, David, you may, in closed session when we discussed it, you know, I don't think there was any mention, based on my memory, of refurbishing the building. It was just the land that we were interested in.
Oh, yeah, I agree with that now, yeah. Tim.
And that came out in the minutes when we approved it. I think you said that we would raise it and plant grass. That's in the minutes. But I'm surprised we've hung on to it this long. In my opinion, there seemed to have been an opinion to refurbish it from county management at a point. Even to the point where we took people over there, and I wouldn't even bother. I wouldn't even go on the tour because I think the building is just needs to go, and the quicker the better.
Well, there is a community garden out in front of it or something, isn't there?
There is a community garden. We've worked with Ag Extension. I think it's called the Graham Community Garden now.
So we can do stuff like that.
We can do
plant
stuff
a bigger
like that.
With the building gone.
Yeah,
but you know the point is there seems to have been an opinion in county management at a time. This was after David, to keep the building. I mean, y'all took tours over there and wanted to show people how Sammy Epps, I think, was involved, how strong the building was. And so I wouldn't even waste my time to go over there and look at it, short of just saying bulldoze it, sucker. I mean, I don't need to see it any further to make my decision. And we need to get rid of it quick. And the quicker the better, but I don't mind waiting another 2 weeks. But
Tim's right. It is a liability. Okay. And it's a lawsuit waiting to happen.
That's what I'm worried about.
Well, are you here enough to send you in a direction that you need to go?
What we will do, and again, we couldn't knock it down tomorrow anyway. So the first direction I'll say, and Richard, you correct me if I'm wrong, is we will get an asbestos abatement plan done from the building, and then we will give you back that information, and we hopefully, how long do you think that'll take, Richard?
Oh, it'll probably take them a week to get out here, about a week for testing.
So probably by our next meeting, we should have that asbestos plan completed. And once we have that, we can go back and get hopefully better bids on the demolition. And we can also try to get with the fire departments and see if there is any interest in using that as a training site as well.
Do they
fire
come
marshal?
On site?
Are the fire departments interested?
I'm sure they would definitely be interested in doing some training there. To what extent, yeah. Maybe obviously from your asbestos abatements and things like that we need to be doing, but those are some options out there, yes, sir. Okay.
Did Griffith come on site when they looked at it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And again, that was worst case scenario, just basically saying there's a ton of asbestos, you know, you're going to have to remove. But again, once we do the abatement plan, we'll know much better.
Clear enough?
We're clear, crystal clear. We'll hopefully have that report ready for you at the next meeting and also those options.
And do you have other comments?
Merry Christmas.
No, you can do that after our conversation.
Oh, okay. All right.
Next on the agenda is a matter for closed session. I'll make closed session motion that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143.318.11(a)(6) to consider the qualifications and conditions of appointment or conditions of initial employment of a public officer or employee. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, we're going to go next door.
Ben, don't go down.